Government, we have Orange Gang. On opening opposition, we have Sambar Namdu. On closing government, we have NALSAR. And on closing opposition, we have Symbiosis Law School Pune. Judging the grand final, we have Parshva, Sanutha, Vasundhara, Sowmya, Pradyumna, Bansal, and myself, Akash, will be your chair. Audience, please keep your clapping to a zero. Do not talk too loudly between speeches. And without further ado, I invite the Prime Minister to open the case for Saitha.
Keep the mic on the other side.
For like putting onus on SLS to ask the first few.
When women are routinely denied jobs because it is too risky to take them, but they might at some point want to leave their job and actually go and have a family. At the point at which you don't think it's risky, you think it's too risky to hire someone who isn't from an elite college because you aren't sure that they can do the job. At the point at which you think it's too risky to make a decision to leave a dead-end job to make your life better, we think that risk aversion has failed people. What do we support on opening government? We support a world where people make choices that could sometimes be risky based upon what they think is most important to them. Maybe they do something as trivial as trying Thai food instead of Indian food when you've never had Thai food in your life. Maybe they also try to do important things, like switching their job, like getting out of a relationship that isn't working for them, like starting a company when you don't feel like your work is meaningful, when you feel like you have something that is important to the world. These are decisions that we think people routinely fail to make because they consider an alternative world where things could go wrong. They think, oh, this company I start could fail. This woman I hire could leave the company. This prevalence or this tyranny of the counterfactual where you don't know what could happen and you always think of the worst case scenario is what we are proud to oppose on opening government. The opposition deans will have to win this debate by telling you why this particular attitude, where you imagine a counterfactual that may never come to pass, that you have no reason to think is going to come to pass, and say why that exactly is something that is beneficial to have in society. Two arguments then in this speech. First, why do we think that risk aversion is fundamentally harmful for human well-being? Three reasons for this. First, we think it often leads people to seek up fewer experiences. You don't want to try new things, or you don't want to have new experiences at the point at which you have had the same experiences that have predictably given you the same amount of happiness in the past. You don't want to try new foods, but it also extends to things that are not as trivial as just the food that you eat, but also things like the decisions you make in terms of whether you're willing to go on a vacation, or whether you're willing to make a decision to move somewhere, to live in a new place, maybe to move out of your family village in these kinds of situations. These are consequential decisions for individual lives, and we do think that making a decision that allows you to maximize the experiences you have is fundamental to being happy as a human being. We think that experiences and new experiences and experiences that make you more happy are fundamental to any kind of conception of human happiness that we can defend in this debate. Second reason, though, you want to tell you about why it's fundamentally harmful for human well-being is that it makes people unwilling to escape bad circumstances. Many people are stuck in circumstances, often through no fault of their own, that they need to get out of, but that they fear there will be negative consequences to that. For example, if you were in a dead-end job, that you graduated from, you with a software engineering degree, that you didn't necessarily want to be a software engineer, and you feel like you have been pushed into doing this for your whole life, these are the kinds of situations in which you feel like you have to stay in this position because the alternative is something that you can't conceive about. Where your risk aversion tells you the alternative to being in the software engineering job my parents have told me about for 10 years is something that I cannot imagine, that I imagine to be the worst possible outcome, where I don't have a job, I don't have any opportunities whatsoever. This is the kind of thing that people aren't able to conceive as a good counterfactual. We think it's often even more pernicious. You think of things like bad relationships, where from a spectrum of a relationship that just isn't working, to even an outright abusive relationship, where people are often unwilling to take a step to make a large change in their life that means that they will not necessarily have the comfort of the status quo. These are situations in which the fact that you can imagine a counterfactual that is bad convinces you that even though the status quo you are experiencing is bad, it can always get worse. This is what prevents people from making decisions that can escape bad circumstances and make them live their lives in a happier way. This is the most important question in the debate, because insofar as people are in literally any kind of circumstance, this argument applies to them. It applies to people from all walks of life, in all countries, in all areas, at any point of time. This is the kind of thing that can define whether you live a happy life as a person. We think it's the most important question to adjudicate in this debate. For that reason, we think that it's fundamentally harmful for human well-being. We prefer a world without risk aversion. Go.
Why is it not equivalently true that you enter a relationship without thinking through it about whether that person is good for you or not, whether that person could abuse you in the future when you're not risk averse?
So we think that what's unique is that the fact that people can make bad decisions in both worlds, but only in our world are they able to unmake those decisions. At the point at which they feel in their world like they have to stay with the decision that they committed because they can't imagine a counterfactual that is different, the fact that they may sometimes make worse choices in our world is completely outweighed by the fact that we can make those choices reversible. In their world, in their very best case that they might want to prove, they might have fewer people making bad decisions. Those people are still going to be far more unhappy in this debate. Second argument I want to give you then is about the economic consequences of risk aversion. We think that there are a number of reasons to believe that the economy is seriously distorted by a world in which people are fundamentally risk averse. Three major areas to talk about here. The first thing is about credentialism. We think the fact that there are so many institutions that are complete gatekeepers that don't actually provide any kind of marketable skill like many colleges, that mostly what they do is convince employers that they are not taking a total risk, that they aren't hiring someone who's an absolute idiot. Where often the third thing that makes it differentiate someone from being a graduate from an elite university or from not being from an elite university is the fact that you are not as certain about the person who is it. We think there are plenty of extremely smart people who haven't had all the opportunities in life that some of their more privileged peers have had, but who have every single capacity to do a job or to do a position that someone else in that same position could do. What we think changes in their world, or what we think is true in their world, is that you're always going to gravitate towards someone with the bigger CV. So for example, someone's always going to want to hire Dhruva instead of me, even though he's really old and really should be looking for a better position. In our world, I can only get a chance to get this job because in that sort of situation, people are willing to take a risk on someone who is not as credential. No. So we think that the most important thing about credentialism is that it creates economic inequality, where people who have been born in disadvantaged situations are unable to escape those disadvantaged situations because everyone who could provide the economic benefit of giving them paths out of mobility, of giving them better schooling, better education, or better jobs is unwilling to do so because they feel like this person is someone who they can't be sure about. When they can't be sure about this person, they're unwilling to try and take that risk. The second thing I want to talk about is how it creates a lack of competition. Why do we think that big companies fundamentally are able to capture the economy in a world with risk aversion? First, because financially, we think that people are much less willing to invest in smaller companies that are trying to compete with bigger companies at the point at which they feel like this big company is what I have experienced as the status quo my whole life. I can't imagine what another company could do to unseat it. These are the kind of things that make small companies unable to raise capital to compete with bigger companies and makes it far less likely that they're able to take down these companies. But secondly, we think that the comparative is that in our world, it's far more likely that people are also willing to, start companies in the first place. They're much willing to leave jobs, to start companies, and to take their skills into a market that could create important kinds of innovation. But they're much more likely to take a risky decision, knowing that it has a lot of upsides, that it could be incredibly important. There are two reasons this is really important. One, because more competition, startups lead to more competition, which can benefit people through lower prices and increased quality and access to goods and services. But secondly, we also think that more startups lead to much more innovation, right? Where you can create jobs or create products that have never existed in the status quo. At the point at which a bank executive quits to go start a mobile money company that can bring financial inclusion to thousands and thousands of people, that's one of the most important impacts in this debate. The economy is not working for people because of risk aversion. We are the ones who actually make sure that it benefits people who are the worst off in society. And we make sure that those people make choices that are better for their lives. We're very proud to propose.
People sitting in the lines of Deutsche were slicing and dicing assets because they decided that that would be fun and risky and would result in a lot of money. The result was global devastation. A culture that encourages risk is a culture that allows those who are most insulated from it to escape the consequences of their actions, whereas those who are most vulnerable to risk suffer forever. We abhor such a culture and believe in the power of risk aversion. What do we stand for? We think the institutions and norms that exist right now, both in terms of societal structure, governments, and so on, should be risk averse. We're happy for things like education and media to encourage individuals and personalities to rethink the decisions they make, to weigh the pros and cons and be more critical about them. We're happy because it also goes against the pre-existing bias of optimism. We want people to be cautious. But remember, this debate is not about risk being used as a proxy for essentially assholery. So the pay gap isn't a corporation deciding to be risk averse, it's just a corporation deciding to be misogynist. We'll debate this on a fair grounds, but don't be ridiculous with your examples. Two arguments in this speech, then rebuttal to Karthik. First, that risk aversion protects the most vulnerable. Second, that risk aversion is an important counter-narrative to other stronger and more terrible countervailing narratives. Five reasons why risk aversion protects the vulnerable. First, because institutions are built for those at risk. A world without risk aversion is a world where we decide things like pensions are not important because why do we have to save for the future? It's a world where we don't build things like social welfare nets because why do we have to save for the contingency that is only a 3% probability according to this Excel sheet that unemployment improves by 5%. That is a world where individuals who are most vulnerable to risk are left out of protective, safe security nets further. But also, that is a world where government policy decisions are not thought out more. They are not slower, they are not elaborately prepared. These are decisions like demonetization that literally cost lives because of the lack of preparation, because they decided moving first before the news leak was more important than preparing for the contingency that people would literally die waiting in ATM lines. This is what results in decisions like Brexit, when people decide that the benefit of that is just probably good enough that we don't have to sit down and really think about all the possible consequences. But the second reason why risk aversion protects the vulnerable is because the vulnerable are always hurt by actions made by those who can afford to be risk averse. Remember, Remember, poor people can't make risky decisions, even if they want to, because they don't have the capital to do so, which means they're often just observers and victims of the market. In such a market, we would rather that the middle class, for instance, launches the market into a savings economy, which can actually insulate the poor and ensure that things like consumption don't crash the way in which it did in 2008. This looks like the poor man still having a job, or the poor woman still being able to go to work and feed their children, because the middle class business owner wasn't making risky decisions along with the rest of the economy. So insofar as the vulnerable are left out of decision-making processes, we're happy that the people making these decisions are being risk averse. But their side is particularly pernicious because it blames the vulnerable for being risk averse. Remember how we push norms in society, right? It's not just a soft process of, oh, let's all just magically wave a wand and become this way. It's a process of shaming, of calling it a moral flaw to be risk averse, calling it guilting individuals who do so. So literally, this looks like a world where a person who chooses to save for their children's education, rather than having a gamble that day on the stocks, or going and having an elaborate wedding and an expensive life, is someone who's shamed on their side of the house. That is pernicious because it hurts the most vulnerable's attempts to creating intergenerational mobility, pushes them into not saving for their future and building up slowly capital and wealth so that future generations of their family can break out of vicious cycles of poverty and vulnerability. But first, there are some individuals in society who will never make decisions for themselves. It is good then for the particular individuals in their families and their lives to make risk averse decisions. This looks like women in conservative societies who will never have the decision on what the family buys or what they spend on. They are often those without agency. But this looks like those who are lost as collateral damage when nations decide to go to war. I would rather that war generals sitting in war rooms or like alcoholic husbands are at least taught to be risk averse, in that they have an implicit bias to at least think about their families or think about the families that will be lost in war and have a tendency to default towards protecting them rather than the risk of hurting them. This is always the best way to protect those without agency. But fifth, for society overall, I think risk aversion reduces volatility. They might have more growth, but they have it at shocks when suddenly every now and then your economy gets hurt, even in the long term, if you grow a little bit faster, it doesn't matter because you keep invalidating the wealth that you kept building. But particularly, investments and savings should be made by individuals in safe things that they can then use on a rainy day. And risky investments should be made by institutional investors who have the ability to absorb risk. That's why risk aversion builds safer, stronger policy systems, stronger security nets, protects those without vulnerability, creates better economics. But even if we have to engage with the economics, there's two reasons why I would rather take this end of the way up. First, because risk is particularly an important way to keep, like an important thing to keep in mind, because even if the probability of a bad event happening might be low, for the poorest individuals and the most vulnerable individuals, one shock is all it takes to destroy their lives. So 2011 sovereign debt crisis is enough to kill the pensioners for eternity, even if hypothetically risk aversion in the future, like risk taking in the future, builds back wealth for everyone else, that shock is permanent enough. But second, stable, slower growth is always better than riskier, shockier, like more volatile, faster growth. We would rather have inclusive wealth and more wealth, and that only comes in this system of risk aversion. It protects the poorest, it protects the most vulnerable. That is something that must be the number one obligation of any norm setting in society. Second argument, risk aversion is an important counter narrative. Three reasons why people are bad at making decisions and need this balancing force in their life. One, because people have optimism bias where they think more about themselves than they actually are. The second, because people are often overconfident. Literally 50% of the population is men, and they think, and 81% of men think they can beat Serena Williams in a tennis match. I would rather that these individuals be risk averse than be allowed to roam free in society. But third, the exception effect, where you always think you are the 9% of startups that don't fail. Startup culture, something they wanted to encourage, but you will probably end up being in the 91%. That's why lottery tickets are still sold at a great percentage every day, because you always think you're the exception. That's bad. I've responded to most of their stuff, some extraneous responses. Remember, this is the way in, right? Sure, people might have more experiences on their side of the house, but many of those experiences are actively going to be shitty experiences. So the way off there, even if this is about the individual lives of people, is having a comfortable mundane life with some good experiences, because you are deliberate in making those decisions, and having a high frequency of going out of your comfort zone and ending up with a lot of negative experiences. I don't see why that is necessarily better than this. Build societies that protect the poor.
I thank that speaker for that speech. I invite the DPM to continue the case for side of my government. Here we go.
That seat is
cursed. What happened?
I forgot to say that.
No, it's fine. I do. One switch judging.
It is rich coming from opening opposition that they don't have to defend assholery, but we have to defend credit rating companies that took kickbacks and lied to the people, something that they call risk-taking, something that we call fraud. It's ridiculous that they tell us that we are supposed to not expect them to defend assholery, while they tell us that Modi demonetizing because he is made of pure evil overnight is something that was him being risk-taking, rather than just him being a racist bigot who didn't think through this policy except for the fact that there would be no money changing hands in Uttar Pradesh. That is not an example of risk-taking. That is the example of assholery that they very importantly and poignantly told us that we shouldn't be expecting anyone to defend in this debate. But what did we say that they have to defend in this debate? It's the fact that when an employer, unfortunately running a small business, looks at a person's prison record, he feels like this individual has gone to prison and may commit a crime again. That is not assholery, that is risk aversion. That hurts a person from being integrated back into society. It's the fact that when you are just starting out, you are unclear whether or not someone who is married and likely to have a child will be your head of HR for the next year. That is not assholery, that is you being risk averse because you are worried even if you are not actively sexist. That is something that they have to defend. Let's quickly get into then some rebuttal to what Hemant tells us. First, Hemant says, you know what, this protects the most vulnerable to be risk averse, because at the end of the day, poor people aren't the ones who are making these decisions. They don't have the capital. But you know who should be risk averse in order to pull them out of poverty? Rich people. What do we mean? This means, one, being willing to bank the unbanked, even if they don't necessarily have the best credit rating, being willing to give them loans and pull them out of their poverty, something that is high risk, but something we should do to make them richer and bring them out of vulnerability. Second, it's the fact that what we need to be doing is putting money into impact startups, which is high risk. It's the fact that investment companies have to invest in developing countries, in infrastructure in these countries, because these are high risk. That protects the vulnerable at the cost of risks to people who they claimed are the most privileged. That is something we protect and support on our side of the house. Second, they said, look, this is the kind of world that says pensions are not important at all. That is a gross mischaracterization. Our world is not a one where everyone is willing to take the highest amount of risk possible. There is still a difference in risk calculus across people. What does that then mean for people and pensions? This means that you don't have to necessarily save 50 or 60% of your income if you are an Indian, as your parents consistently tell you every day of your life. Rather, it is justifiable for you to spend that money on a movie that you want to watch with your friends. It is justifiable for you to spend that money to go see something new in the world, even if that means that you don't have all the money left behind for yourself when you're older. We think that is an acceptable counterfactual. That's the one they have to contend with. They can't strawman us in this debate. Then they say, look, we'd rather that alcoholic husbands be risk averse for women in conservative societies. First off, we'd rather that alcoholic husbands aren't alcoholic to begin with. But more importantly, let's talk about what actually helps women in conservative societies. It's when their parents are bold and decide to take the risk of educating them rather than saying, let's do the thing that we do all the time and get them married because that's low risk. It's when their parents are bold and tell them that they can break barriers and do jobs that aren't just them being mothers or nurses or teachers, but rather tell them that they should go to an engineering university even though that's high risk. That is unfair for them to tell us that risk aversion is good for women in conservative societies. Finally, they say, you know what, stable growth is incredibly important and therefore we should all be risk averse. What creates stable growth is a real question. Our answer to that question is that competition creates stable growth. And here's where they didn't engage with our argument on why we are the side that creates competition. At the point where large companies, because of your risk aversion, are the ones entrenched in your economy or hold monopolies, you have lesser competition and lesser stable growth, as they put it, because they are able to capture your economy and your systems and hold you at ransom. They can't just tell us stability without an explanation of this. They've got to explain to us how you get to that stability. We actually think risk-taking, relatively more risk-taking, takes you there. Finally, they say, you know what, why would people not equivalently enter a bad relationship because you didn't think it through? Here are reasons for why individuals will be in bad relationships that have nothing to do with risk aversion, risk-taking. And that's what's important to note in this debate, because our side tells you that bad choices do not come from risk-taking. Therefore, making a bad choice is not unique to risk-taking. But the things that we give you as benefits are unique in that they cannot happen in a world with risk aversion. So let's quickly tell you why that bad choice of getting into that relationship will exist regardless. Because people can still hide information about themselves. Because at the end of the day, you can never truly calculate what an individual is going to be like in a relationship or match your preferences to them. In that circumstance, their world of risk aversion, because you can't have enough information about this or think this through enough, precisely because you just don't know enough about a human being, will result in, well, pretty much no one being in relationships. Surely that's not the world they support. Therefore, it is true and likely that people in their world are going to be in bad relationships. In that circumstance, who is the person who is willing to take the risk, even though they know they have two kids in the home of an abuser, and leave it or get a divorce in a conservative society? Hemant.
If anything, conservative parents, when not risk averse, will marry their child off while underage because they're not frightened of the law. When people tend to be assholes, risk aversion makes them less riskier, less worse off assholes.
Okay, this is so confusing. The reason that you marry your child off when they're 14 years old is because you don't want to take the risk of social exclusion from your community. As a result, we actually think it's good for your child even if it comes at the cost of you being discriminated against by your neighbors, to be married at 21 or 22 rather than at 14. Finally, why do we think social movements are better off on our side of the house? We often think that the people who are the poorest will end up protesting regardless. This is not about them because they have no other choice. Who then is a person that can affect change? Middle-income individuals who stay back at home because they don't want to take the risk of going out to the streets and protesting. We wish that they were a little bit less risk-averse like they are in Hong Kong right now. Second, middle-income individuals in startup organizations that won't start things off for women and sell sanitary pads because that just seems like a risky proposition for them to have moonshot ideas. They take more risks on our side of the house. Finally, we tell you that it is untrue, this optimism bias that they speak so much about, because people only have optimism the things that they have already done in the past. For new things, you more often than not think you will fail. Proud to be here one last time for Orange Gang, opening government, the real OGs.
I thank our speaker for that speech and guide the deputy of opposition here.
Strategy to define good decisions as risky decisions and then defend good decisions for your entire case. We are a much more realistic side, which says there are good decisions, like choosing to hire a woman. There are also bad decisions, like choosing not to have an HR department because you're willing to take the risk of having to deal with these situations on a case-by-case basis. There are good decisions, like choosing to educate your girl child. There are bad decisions, like spending her savings on the stock market because you think you can get away with it and make good money on the stock market because you're not risk averse, and therefore not have money to send her to school when the time comes to send her to college. There are good decisions and bad decisions. We are going to be the side that, rather than cherry pick our examples, give you structural reasons as to why we are the side where risk aversion results in more of the good decisions being made than the bad decisions. So a couple of ways of dealing with this logjam that's going to last till the end of the debate if we don't fix it right now at DLO. The first thing that they tried to do in OG to explain why you can, to break out of this is to say, in the absence of risk aversion, or when risk aversion exists, you can never unmake a decision because you're too scared to leave. Here's the problem. Risk aversion doesn't mean inaction. We live in risk-averse societies and people take actions all the time. Rather, risk aversion means that you think a lot more about the negative consequences that happen and bake that into your calculus when you are making that decision. What that means, for instance, is if you do invest in a startup, or if you do spend, if you do decide to quit your job to start your own business, realizing that there is a large likelihood that you will fail and making sure that you have some savings to fall back on rather than falling into poverty because you've thought and overweighted the negative consequences that could occur. So that's the basic thing that we need to clarify. The question then becomes, in which world are you as a person more likely to get to the right decision? What they try to present this as is a situation where a company doing something like hiring women is always a risky decision. But what we're going to claim is that for companies and for people, often the risky decision is the right decision to make, but it's only the right decision after they've thought about it. Why is the time that you get due to risk aversion, where you spend time thinking carefully about the negative consequences, useful? First, because you think about yourself as a person and what your preferences are. Before you enter a relationship, you think really carefully about whether that person is right for you, whether your interests are aligned, whether the vision that you have for the future is aligned. What that means is you understand yourself better when you're making a decision. Second, you can get access to better information. Because you as a country are deciding to make a policy, we think it is useful for you to wait and carefully think about the research, carefully think about what sort of information exists before making that decision. It is not true that people make decisions that are bad because they're racists and bigots, or that countries make bad decisions because they are simply stupid. It's often because they're not risk-averse enough and not thinking about the negative consequences enough. So the second reason is you get access to better information, which you don't get access to on their side of the house. And that responds to their company's argumentation as well.
Because in fact, it is risk-averse companies that are more likely to do things like hire women, because research now shows that women and having a diverse workplace is good for your bottom line. What that means is that it is in your risk-averse interest to have a diverse workplace, something you get on our side of the house. In comparison, you're not likely to make stupid risky decisions, no thank you, like not have an HR department, to flout the law because you think you can get away with it. The final reason that risk aversion leads you to the better decision is because you can see other people that have made the decision and then based on how it's worked out for them, make the decision yourself. So what this means, for instance, is that if you're thinking about whether to leave a relationship or not, you can look at examples of other people who've left relationships and see that it's actually worked out well for them and therefore leave the relationship. In some situations, maybe it's not worked out well for the others. Maybe in deeply conservative societies, when a woman leaves a relationship, she's flung out of that community, thrown into poverty, and has no support structure. Those are hard decisions to make, but we would rather that people think through the deep negative consequences that could accrue before making those decisions. You only get that on our side of the house. So on our side of the house, there are good decisions and bad decisions. But the benefit of time is that you think about these decisions and you account for the worst cases and you make better decisions overall. The second question, no thank you, about how to break this logjam is that there are good decisions and bad decisions, but some people are more able to bear the risks of bad decisions than others are. And we explain to you uniquely why those different risks are borne by different people only on our side of the house. Go ahead.
You've got the benefit of time as long as you're just cognizant of risk. Being risk-averse requires you to think of the worst counterfactual, and in human nature, by definition, you are less likely to make that decision if you think of the worst things.
Yeah, great. So you're literally defining risk aversion as saying that you are paralyzed into inaction because all you think about is the worst cases and you don't do anything. We say you think about the worst cases, prepare for those worst cases, and then do the decision if that makes sense for you. We think that's what risk aversion looks like. I don't know what characterization of society you're painting where people don't do anything, never cross the road because there's the risk that they might get hit by a car. That's obviously not the world we live in. So second, different amounts of risk can be borne by different people. I have a flight at 11 p.m. today. The reason I'm not panicking the shit out of my head right now is because I know that I have enough money to buy another ticket if I need to buy another ticket. The problem is, in a world where risk is valorized, where not taking a risk is being told by society that you are shameful, that you're not courageous, that you're holding the country back, to use their economic language, by you not going out and starting that company, you're being unpatriotic, you're spineless and you lack courage, it tells the poorest in society, the most vulnerable, who cannot afford to take the kinds of risks that they want people to take, of just going out and saying, fuck it, I'm going to start a company, even though 91% of companies fail. These are the people who feel the most hurt, who feel shamed and feel like they do not belong in this society. But crucially, we told you in a very practical way that these people are hurt. Because what are the sorts of institutions that you get when a society isn't built for risk aversion? They try to make this debate about startups and so on. We think that a risk-averse society is one where, for instance, all employers are required by law to put a certain amount of salary into a retirement account because the society is built around the idea that saving for retirement is a good idea. When these institutions are baked into society, it is the poor and vulnerable who benefit because they can't afford to take the risk. The rich will always take risks. The wealthy will always take risks. Companies will always try and find better people to hire, more women to hire. Those are not the people we're concerned about. The question in this debate today is, on balance, who leads to better decisions? And on balance, who can bear the risk? We're proud to say that we resolve that.
I thank that speaker for that speech. I invite the member of government to open the case to cite to our government. Thank you.
Panel, the reason you may be torn between the two opening teams we just witnessed right now is because both of them give us examples, a lot of examples of good outcomes and bad outcomes, and paint them as risk-averse and risk-taking respectively. They don't give any principled or mechanistical structural reasons why something like that is risk-averse or risk-taking is likely in most cases to be a good outcome or a bad outcome. We first believe that risks are often painted in the language of an oppressor, which is that the way that society defines what is risky and what is not risky is through these oppressive structures. It's going to tell you, a capitalist society is going to tell you that valuing money is really important, and thereby it is risky for you to quit a job and follow your passion. It's going to tell you that it is risky to alienate your family when you're a woman, and hence it is risky to then probably file when you're facing domestic abuse. And it's structurally, oppressors are better placed to paint what risks are and what should be valued as risky or not, because they have better control over media that tells you what good and bad experiences you have. They're able to fund more into research that paints a specific activity or a specific negative consequence and exaggerates in a manner that tells and paints a picture of some a specific activity being risky for people. They also create structures that use criteria that make it risky for a specific set of individuals. For instance, they will make, employment will require that you need to be present at all days from this period to this period, which means the criteria that mandates that women probably who are, want to take a pregnancy leave can't take that job up is good. The criteria they set tends to make things riskier for a certain set of individuals than the rest, right? By exaggerating how tough certain things are, they're able to use these coercive mechanisms into making things a lot more risky, seem a lot more risky for the poor, unprivileged, and the least, and the most vulnerable. And that's why we think that encouraging risk aversion is bad, because, is bad, right? Let OO not tell you, like, push the burden on us to defend all reckless behavior. And let them not get away by telling you that risk aversion merely means that now you're going to think about your decisions better and make better decisions. Because we think that everyone thinks about their decisions anyway. Risk aversion means that you think far more about the negative consequences and exaggerate the harms that could come to you. That's not really what risk aversion is. They tell you countries make racist decisions because they're not spending the time to think about the bad outcomes. No, countries make racist decisions because they don't want to risk alienating a white majority that's going to be pissed off by you not making the racist decision, right? So that's really not the burden in this debate. But what's a really important like micro level advantage we create when individuals are not risk averse, right? We think that a risk averse individual, and as we've established, these are usually the most underprivileged and minorities because society paints risks to be far higher for them, constantly lives in fear, which means they grossly undervalue what they can do in the world, what they can achieve by getting education or traveling to a new city to find employment, which means that the optimism bias that they talk about and how people think things are going to be great really only exists with the privileged and the rich who think the life is great anyway. Poor people think their life is bleak. They don't really have this optimism bias. They think that because they live in fear, and they live in fear because society paints things as really risky. Now, but let's also talk about which side of the house better protects the most vulnerable from harm, right? They tell you we protect them from harm because we prevent them from doing things that may have negative consequences for them. We disagree here because we think that you're not protecting them from harm when you force them to continue to live in structures that oppress them, right? When you continue to tell a Dalit individual that running for political office is going to be a risky affair, and that's when they continue to live in those structures and they suffer more harm. They never really get the opportunity to speak up against those structures or try to dismantling them because that's really risky for them. We think that they're able to paint things like migrants entering Europe will be really risky for the economy and everything. And this is because all these structures are framed through the voice and the narrative of the oppressor. We think when you continue to keep these individuals in these structures without offering them outlets, which are probably risky to break them, they're all being harmed anyway. But now let's talk about like what political consequences we get out of this, right? Which is that people don't explore the possibilities of an alternative, which is like someone running for a minority running for political office or taking up a cause that hasn't been represented before because it's regarded as risky. We think that you're likely to ensure that these things are less risky for people in the future when more minorities take the risk and enter this political space. This also applies to the debate we had about the startup culture, because the point at which more individuals take risks and there are more startups in the market changes itself to be conducive for startups being a less risky affair. We think by a few individuals initially taking risks, you're able to transform, say, political structures or economic structures into being less riskier for people who are being oppressed by them anyway. But lastly, and really importantly, we think on a micro level, when minorities don't take risks, and then we've established why minorities are most likely to not take risks in this paradigm, we fail to create precedents or success stories for people who are in the same position as them. And it's important because, as we've told you earlier, these people already live in bleak worlds, and they have a less, they have a devalued understanding of what they can probably achieve in society. It's important for you to then create success stories or precedents of things working out for them to then take those leaps of faith and enter and explore those opportunities anyway. Yeah.
Do you really think that a world where more minority kids are encouraged to drop out of school and drop out of college is a better world for these people?
It could be, right? Because at a point in time when minority kids are dropping out of school to pursue something that's probably something that they're more passionate about, we think that's fine. But we also think that minority kids currently drop out of school because they think that investing that amount of resources in education is probably a risk. Not investing a certain set of resources in education is a form of risk aversion, right? Because they'd rather save that money to have food and shelter with them than invest in their future. And that's when they're able to take those leaps of faith, and that's when they're able to transform how these structures look. Because they enter these structures only when risk taking is prioritized. Because otherwise for them, it's really risky for them to enter these structures to begin with. And as you have more, the presence of more minorities in these structures, they transform and make it less harmful for the most vulnerable. We give you a structural reason why risk aversion is bad and it's the worst for minorities. We tell you how taking risks will make it far better, there's going to be change, and how individuals have more self-worth and feel better about ourselves, about themselves. Very happy to propose.
Thank that speaker for that speech, and by the member of opposition. Yeah, yeah.
One thing that we agree with closing government on, that they tell you that there is no principal justification against the examples and the consequences that you get from opening half. That is to say, most of the debate in the opening half here right now has been fixated on examples which have been shoved by either side without telling you the exact incentive structures which go beyond the making of such decisions, right? We think that something very important comes from closing government, but we think that that is adequately tackled by opening opposition as well. And we'll do that before going on to why we give you a principled calculus as to how, on a utilitarian premise at least, closing opposition will take this case. Notice that when they talk about minorities or oppressed people functioning within a world where there exists risk aversion, where there exists a capacity to understand the kind of structures which are existing against me, and despite that you have outlier success stories, you're required to ask why that happens, right? And when you do that, you understand that what opening tells you is actually true. Opening opposition tells you that I first look at the risk, I do feel threatened if that is what government is saying, but then I look at the kind of loss that I'm sustaining in my real life. And as a result of that, I evaluate it and I think that me going against it will lead to some kind of change. We believe that outliers exist even in a world where there exists risk aversion because they are capable of appreciating the fact that the risk does not offset the kind of oppression that they presently face, right? That is fundamentally the reason why you have success stories which are made examples out of. But let us understand that they don't go forward and they don't characterize the entirety of the risk of the risky nature in front of you, right? They tell you that risks are often painted in the language of the oppressor without telling you how exactly this comes to be. Let us tell you this, right? We tell you that people, being egotistic by nature, people by having selfish motives, as they rightly point out on government, in their nature, are often capable of influencing the kind of choices that they have. That is to say,
people trying to act on our side of the house, where people are risk averse, we see that individuals will not take decisions which affect them detrimentally, both on an individual or a societal level. That is to say, on closing government, we will tell you that you are more likely to take decisions on their world which have inordinately negative consequences into the future, where the risk does not affect you at the present moment. Right? That is what we tell you is, when you are incapable of looking at a risk which might directly impact you, and these are the most critical risks that we talk about, instances like climate change, instances like you oppressing people in a genocidal regime, because you never think that there exists an alternative where you might be called out for the kind of actions that you undertake, is something that will be furthered on the side of government, right? Let us paint my case first, and then I'll take their case down through rebuttals, because they don't give you any principle as to that. Firstly, what do we mean by this? I'll give you two examples and I'll draw it from it, right? Firstly, on a societal level, we think that you do not regret acting in a manner which is prodigal and which compromises the agency or compromises the rights of another party. So when you look at oppressive regimes, for that matter, wherein you do have the capacity of influencing other sides of other behaviors, or patriarchal structures where you're capable of influencing the lives of other people, perhaps women in their case, perhaps minorities in their case, we believe that it is not having risk aversion to the kinds of consequences which might impact you into the future, because the present structures don't exist right now, that you take such decisions. Look at what happens in their case, in their own cases, in their own examples, right? When they talk to you about minorities, when they talk to you about people who are oppressed in the present day, the people who are oppressing them also become, let's say, also lose the capacity of appreciating this risk further. That is to say, someone who did not have the ability to comprehend that they might be affected badly in the future becomes even more oppressive, because they think they never will. So the problems are even further aggravated on their side of the house. If they give you outlier examples as to minorities rising up against them, we see that happening in a risk-averse society as well, because they look at the circumstances, they think that emancipation is something which is far more likely, which is far more beneficial for them, and they strive towards that. We think that even when you have a couple of examples to that effect, they are capable of inspiring change, where people think that, hey, perhaps the risk is not as much as government is painting it out for me to be. And only then do you have proper fixated examples for a proper fixated movements on our side of the house. Why is this exceptionally necessary? You only take those steps which are moderated by a sense of risk, which are moderated by an understanding of what the opposite party is capable of doing to you, and you take better policies, you take better movement measures in your movement which have a higher chance of succeeding, because you have weighed every option, because you have not thought that anything and everything will work in your favor, and thus you get better movements, right? We tell you that on our side, you have the capacity of engaging in this, because people being risk averse takes them away from their fundamental feeling which they think justifies their existence, which is they are justified in pursuing pleasure, and the more proximate it is to them, the more incapable they are of appreciating future risk. Notice that no team thus far has given this to you on any side, and that is our extension. We tell you that the worst kinds of perpetrations against people are the least likely on closing opposition. Why? Because we give you a principled justification as to how a person will be capable of appreciating future risks which might not necessarily affect him, which might not necessarily affect the kind of people that he's around, but he will at least think that that is a legitimate possibility, and thus I will be more moderated towards it. And notice that we also have movements, the only thing that they give to you in this calculus on our side of the house, because people still have outlier examples. Closing government explicitly tells you that success stories are not something that they like. We tell you that success stories are the primary reason why you have the capacity of engaging. Before I move on, opening.
Despite you trying to shame us for debating the real world, we told you that powerful people want to maintain an oppressive status quo because of risk averse. So vulnerable people cannot escape poverty if rich people are not willing to give them a loan and escape the status quo where they don't get those loans to begin with.
I'll take that on two levels, right? The example that they give you and what I've already told you thus far. When they tell you that powerful people are risk averse, I think I've adequately dealt with that already. And secondly, when they tell you that this risk aversion is persistent within the oppressed community as well, we think that is a good thing, because this gives them a moderated calculus where they understand the best possible outcome, where they understand the best possible mechanism of assaulting that oppression in the first place, and they don't go forward with any and every policy that is thrust at them. Notice that there is no engagement, despite this being a legitimate contention from their side. All houses thus far have engaged only with their best case. But secondly, which is the economic example that they populated throughout with different kinds of satisfaction, I guess, to a level, we take that as well, right? Because If they tell you that startups are a larger possibility on their side of the house, we think that startups of aggregation are a larger possibility on their side of the house. Thus, you have more wastage of capital. Thus, you don't have proper competition where there are good companies fighting it out with each other, which we think we'll bite the bullet. Even in our worst case, where you have only the best ideas percolate into society, we think that only the best kinds of ideas actually come forward. They've not engaged with that. We're the only team which gives you principal justification. Very proud to oppose. Thank you.
I thank that speaker for that speech and invite the government whip to conclude this case for saying. Okay.
Can I start? Thank you, Chair Speaker. On the side closing opposition, we've heard a lot of material about how people are somehow going to continue taking behaviors that are good for them while somehow also being risk averse. They seem to conflate being risk averse with being able to make a good decision for you. They seem to conflate the ability to weigh the pros and cons of any decision with the fact that you consider these cons to be significantly worse. In their paradigm, it's possible for you to follow an outlier or for an outlier to even take place. But outliers only take place because people are willing to go against the odds. People are willing to take these risks. And people are only willing to follow these outliers, knowing that they're outliers if they're willing to take on that risk. And that's something that they completely refuse to engage with. They've also completely refused to deal with any of our substantive points wherein they don't tell you how risks are, wherein we've already told you how risks are defined by the oppressor for three reasons. That there exists a control over the media by the people who are in power, that there exists a control over the media by people whose position in society would be threatened, that there exists an ability for these people to influence the research that percolates to people, and there exists the ability for these people to exaggerate these risks. This exaggeration of risk is something that's crucial for our side because of the fact that this exaggeration is what constitutes risk aversion. Risk aversion constitutes a overweighing of the negative aspects, and to the extent that society is able to continue to play into this fear, it's extremely important who defines these risks. Secondly, we've also told you that minorities live in a society of fear. But in both sides, I've tried to tell you that minorities on their paradigm are somehow going to be better off and will be willing to take these risks. Minorities aren't always in these positions. Minorities are in a position where the information that they're fed right now is information that is the worst. Information that percolates to minorities is things like when black people go to college, 75% of them drop out. What's the point of you going to college? You'll drop out anyway. These are the sort of risks that are painted to them by society. We tell you that therefore there is no optimism bias that can exist, and there is also no precedent of success that exists. When they talk to you about these outliers, they don't consider how these outliers come to exist. The example of Bill Gates perhaps being able to quit Harvard to get into starting up his own tech company isn't really something that would exist if Bill Gates was told that everybody who leaves Harvard ends up getting fucked, whereas everybody in Harvard does well. I agree that Bill Gates is rich, but at the end of the day, risk aversion is risk aversion, whether or not you're rich or poor. Fine. Moving on to our third substantive point, we want to talk about how they've come here and told you repeatedly that they protect minorities from harm. We tell you that that's not true for two key reasons. Firstly, that there exist structures of society which continue to oppress people. I think you're after the fifth minute, could you not? That there exist structures of society that continue to oppress people and that continue to make them in a worse off position, and these structures continue to feed people this negative information, and these people continue to be excluded from this because of their risk aversion. Further, we also told you that it prevents them from entering these spheres. Spheres wherein people are not generally accepted, contrary to their belief, are spheres wherein there's an enormous risk associated with merely being part of it. So therefore, when somebody who, let's say, doesn't speak Hindi that well joins RVC or NALSAR's DevSoc and comes forward to their first practice debate, realizes that everybody who isn't comfortable with that language does far worse than people who are. That's a risk that they need to be willing to take, and that's not really something that takes place. This is broader, and it's also seen on the economic and political sphere. And therefore, without engaging with that, they somehow believe that risk will magically go away. Now, moving on to the side opening opposition. Opening opposition has provided you a bunch of reasons why somehow poor people are going to get better off. We tell you that structurally this is not the case. Why do we believe this? We believe that all of their examples of people who will somehow continue to be able to save up, people who won't engage in risk-taking behaviors because they're worried about these risks, these aren't necessarily the people who have the ability to save money. These aren't people who have the examples that they can look at. Somebody whose family continues to work as daily wage employers, people whose families are employed at McDonald's, etc., aren't really people who have family savings, people who don't have family role models to look outside of. These people, their risks are very different to us. There is a constituted by going outside this stable job. Going outside this stable job is something that they can't really do. And without being able to do that, they aren't in a position where they're able to pull themselves out of that position. Therefore, we talk about how this is a structure that continues to entrench a certain cyclical belief. As they haven't dealt with this cyclical nature of poverty and the fact that poverty in itself cannot be escaped by dealing with these structures, they should clearly follow the debate, because their only basis for this is a belief that somehow some individual people will be better off because they will be in a position to save. We tell you that the debate isn't just about them. This is about people who are even worse off. This is about people whose only avenue to success is looking outside their own examples, is people who need to go out of their comfort zone in order to be able to succeed. And that is something that they completely refuse to engage with.
Your entire extension is really good analysis for why the vulnerable are unlikely to be able to bear the cost of taking risks. In this situation, why is it better that they get shamed and live in a society that isn't built for them?
We tell you that that's not always the case. Their risks aren't always going and joining a startup company. It's making the decision to go from working every day at McDonald's to joining night school every couple of nights a week. That's a completely different paradigm. We're not talking about risks that they need to be have to invest that much in. Merely because of the fact that you see your negative outcomes being that much worse than the positive outcomes, you look at the fact that these negative outcomes dissuade you from taking any measures, not only measures that have high costs associated with them, to the extent that they continue to conflate cost of measures with mere anything, that they should not, you should not take their points as being legitimate. They also seem to come here and tell you that all risk-taking will basically give you time to introspect. That's not the case. Being paralyzed by fear doesn't necessarily contrary to taking time to think about things in a measured manner. We tell you that when you are risk-averse, when you are worried about the negative outcomes, it's things like debaters sitting in that, sitting there taking a smoke break after a debate going, dude, that ads looked at me in a weird way, so there's 100% chance we're going to do badly in this round. That's the sort of fear that negativity persists. That's not really taking time to introspect clearly. That's really decision-making that's paralyzed by fear. Why do we believe we also take it over our opening? Our opening has come here and given you a lot of examples about how certain individual people might be better off, wherein they're able to apply for jobs, wherein their applications are taken seriously, or venture capitalists give them more money. We tell you that that's well and good, but that's not really a structural issue. We've given you actual concrete reasoning as to why these structures exist, why these structures continue to perpetuate a situation wherein people on the margins continue to be on the margins, and why these structures cannot really be changed by any means other than taking risks. To that extent, merely telling people that you should apply for a job because you'll get a good job, merely telling people that competition will be there in the market isn't necessarily enough. You need to show us why necessarily. This is always the case in all sorts of situations. Not only why some people in some situations are better off, which is why we take this debate and which is why we are very proud to oppose.
That's the speaker for that speech, and by the opposition group to conclude the case for side opposition. Hear that.
In their best case, we have a few more Bill Gates, but they do not tell you at what cost that is. At the cost of so many people who tried to be Bill Gates, but did not understand that everyone is not. They don't, like they did not understand that not everyone is an exception, because people are less likely, as Sayantan told you, to understand long-term effects of decisions, right? What we tell you is that human nature is that such, is that we are able to appreciate tangible, immediate gratifications. We are more likely to take decisions that can show us immediate benefit, which means that we are less likely to think of long-term. And why this is bad is because it usually turns out to be regretful. And why regret is bad? Because like that's essentially which puts you in a cloud of taking further bad decisions. Regret is essentially what scares you from now taking decisions that maybe you should have taken, right? We believe regret is not good. We are okay if there are no more Bill Gates, but it's still a better world, because maybe we have lesser people who are sad, we have lesser people who are homeless, we have lesser people who could have had a simple mundane job but like are now jobless because they didn't complete college, right? What does opening government give you? They tell us in an umbrella that personal choices like maybe changing your job or getting out of a relationship need you to take a risk, right? And here's a 3-point rebuttal to why that is wrong, right? First is that these decisions are usually taken at the spur of the moment, right? You're usually taking out of like peer pressure or out of like something sudden grief or out of sudden emotions that you offend. You're less likely to think about how it's going to pan out in the future, right? Which means they're not well thought out, right? You're not likely to be objective about a decision. You're not likely to see whether you really have a CV that can give you another job, because all you care about is, I hate this job and I want to leave this job, right? Maybe if you give it some more time, you can actually figure out how that job can be nice for you, or take some more time, plan out 2 more years of taking some internships, some fellowships, and actually now becoming capable of the job that you want to take, right? And the third thing we tell you is, in their world, there is so much regret, right? Because like maybe you got out of a relationship really like fast, or you moved a job like really fast, and now you feel like really sad about it. And we feel that like loses confidence in people, that like doesn't allow them to take decisions further in life, right? The second thing we tell you is, they have a problem with employers not taking risk, right? We believe that is their job, right? We think employers are supposed to like prioritize their like profits. Employers are supposed to like prioritize how their office functions, right? And it's, I mean, if they're taking people just from Ivy League, it's because they're maybe objectively better. If there are outliers who are more innovative or who think they can do better than them objectively, we think it's fair that burden to prove that they're better is on that person. We don't think this employer is someone who has to risk his profit or his like office for that person, right? And that's what we tell you. The third thing is, they talk about unique benefits, right? I would not like to talk math, but it's the language of logic. So if they want to tell you that like they are going to have unique benefits that we will not have access to, we tell you that we have less people who are like harming out of it, right? Which brings us to a clock. Would you rather have like try and fail, or would you like rather like not fail, right? And this is where our extension comes into being, right? We tell you, it is only when you take lesser chance and when you look out at the negative consequences that you do things that are profitable for the society at large, right? That's what we tell you. That's our principle. We tell you that a robber is less likely to think that he is going to be the one who is not going to get caught and rob the house anyways. We tell you that it's less likely in our house, that in our world, that a child is going to think that a teacher has unfair restrictions in the room, because like it's going to think that maybe like the negative consequences are so much that law should be abided by. We feel like more laws are going to be followed in our paradigm, because people are now going to think that like the negative consequences are possible. The next thing we tell you is that, why is it so important that these negative consequences are exaggerated when you want to take a decision? And that's again our extension, right? What we tell you is that we are so likely to fall and tempt into something that's tangible and immediate, that it is only when there is a shock value to the negative consequences that we are likely to think long term, right? It's only when you think that, oh my god, this is possible, that you are likely to go out of your comfort zone and think little more objectively and not give in to the spur of the moment, right? That is our extension. Coming to the closing government, when they talk about oppressive structures, we think that oppressive structures are real, right? Which means that in our world, if a poor child is believing that there's no way it can go to a best school, that's good, right? Because we think that there is no way that child can go to a best school, and that's why that structure exists, right? But this is a second layer of argument we tell you, and that's that there will be some children who think that there are a lot of negative consequences. There is a chance that I'm just going to be homeless and I'm going to reach nowhere. But I care about this way more than those negative consequences, and hence I choose to be an outlier. Outliers do exist in our world, right? There are people who think of negative consequences, but then think that the benefits that they acquire can objectively be more than these, right? And that's when we believe decisions are taken in our world, and that's how decisions progress. We believe these outliers are now the people who decrease the risk for others to follow, right? And we believe that this steady change in oppressive structures is least harmful to the people who are oppressed, right? And that's why we take that. What we tell you is that a balance of success stories that is outliers and negative effects is something that is required in this world, right? I need Bill Gates, of course, to tell me that you can become a millionaire. But on the other hand, I also need to know that there are so many people who have failed trying to do that. It's only when in this world where, like, I don't believe that I am the Bill Gates, without seeing if I have more in common with these people who couldn't become Bill Gates, is when I take the right decisions, or I am less likely to get hurt, right? We believe that it's only our closing opposition that has told you how it is important to have a shock value. It's because of the innate human nature. And it's two, only our house that has told you how this pans out in the society at large, right? It's, we have less criminals. We have more people abiding by law. We have, and we believe if we have lesser startups, that's okay, right? I mean, I hope that point is delivered. And that's that it's okay if we have lesser startups, because there is huge amount of risk. If I'm leaving my job and it means that I'm putting my family in financial danger, it means that I may never ever have a good career again. It is okay if I rather not do that. Proud to oppose.